man, so I thought I'd take a chance. Papa ran, Papa ran, Papa ran, Papa ran, Papa ran. Thanks for it, you got me rocking and a rolling, rocking and a reeling. Papa ran, Papa, Papa ran,
Papa, Papa, Papa ran.
Everybody, it's your old Aunt BB. Y'all didn't know Aunt BB was a DJ, did ya? Well, today Aunt BB was a little nostalgic and decided to pick a theme song. So this is my song. My real name is Barbara Ann, and the Beach Boys released this song in 1965 when old Aunt BB was just 6 years old. And I remember my older sister driving me around once she got her driver's license, and she would sing this song to me. So anyway, that's my little fun today. But today I've got a serious topic to discuss with you. I am in Kamloops, British Columbia, Canada, attending the BC Green Party Convention. And I'm a member. I'm a dual citizen from Virginia originally. But I'm here for the convention, and it just so happens that the leader of the Green Party of Canada will be here, Elizabeth May, and she represents what they call a riding here. The district that she represents is on Vancouver Island in British Columbia. And what's interesting is Elizabeth May has a connection to the Clintons. So let's look into Elizabeth May's connection to the Clintons. So let's see here. Oh, look, here's Elizabeth May's official biography on the Green Party of Canada website. And look who's there. It's Bill. Bill Clinton is right there. See him? And this is a young Elizabeth May. I think that's her mother. I don't know if that's Elizabeth May's daughter. I'm not sure. But anyway, yeah, there's a Clinton connection. And let's find another one here. Oh, look, here we go. So Elizabeth May, she is very proud of the fact that three of her ancestors signed the U.S. Declaration of Independence, because Elizabeth May is from Connecticut. She was born there and she grew up there until her family moved to Canada in Nova Scotia when she was 18 or 19, I think. Her parents were from, they were native New Yorkers, and her dad had actually grown up in England, I believe. And it's kind of strange that she would be proud of the fact that her ancestors signed the Declaration of Independence, because Elizabeth May embraces the British monarchy, because you may or may not know, Queen Elizabeth is the head of state of Canada. So it also says here, yeah, growing up in Connecticut. So she, Bill Clinton, she's very proud of the fact that Bill Clinton wrote her a letter of recommendation so that she could get into law school as a mature student. So yeah, she didn't have a bachelor's degree. I had never heard of that until fairly recently, that you can enter law school without even having a bachelor's degree, but that's what she did. She earned her law degree. And let's see what else we can find out about Elizabeth. Oh, yeah. Here we go. Let's see. No, that's not it. Yes, this is it. Here's the video. So let's just listen to this video. Oh, just a little intro. This woman here, this is Adrienne Carr. So she's from British Columbia too. And she was the original head of the BC Green Party. She was a spokesperson. And she then later became a deputy leader to Elizabeth May as deputy leader of the Green Party of Canada. So let's listen to Adrienne Carr here bragging about Elizabeth May's connection to Bill Clinton. Isn't that wonderful? Bill Clinton loves Elizabeth May. Isn't that something to be proud of? Yes, a serial rapist, a serial sexual harasser loves Elizabeth May. Okay, let's hear more about Elizabeth May's connection from Elizabeth herself.
Can you talk a bit about how you came to know President Clinton? You talk about it in the book, but maybe people just like to learn a little bit more about that, because that seems like a pretty interesting relationship for a current federal leader to have with a former U.S. president.
Yes, well, he of course, when I met him, he wasn't. He was a Yale Law School student. Mm-hmm. So I was born in the States. And this is a big theme in my early years, and talk about in the book, my mother's activism, and she was very involved through my whole life in numerous campaigns leading to being involved in anything to try to stop the war in Vietnam. So she became involved in supporting candidates who wanted to end the war in Vietnam, which led her to work for Eugene McCarthy in 1968. And in 1971, in the summer of 1971, Bill Clinton, a young Yale law student, made an appointment to come meet with us, knocked on the door, my mom, wanted to meet my mom because she was a very effective organizer. And Senator George McGovern was putting together his campaign team. And they were asking my mom if she would volunteer and work in the McGovern for President campaign. So, I mean, I don't mind telling you, I don't quite describe it like this in the book, I don't think. But I was 17 years old. I opened the front door. My knees caved. And I think, oh, my God, this beautiful. Anyway.
Can you believe that? And this is in 2014. This interview is in 2014. So this is after all these revelations about Bill Clinton and his, assaulting women, harassing women. Isn't that something? And Elizabeth May is proud of this relationship with Bill Clinton.
Never mind. Bill at law school was quite something. And I was making iced tea and bringing it to the back porch for my mom and Bill. And he was really, really wonderful to me always. He treated me like...
Oh, yeah. He's wonderful to women.
...an older brother. He was thoughtful and kind. And immediately, because he could see I had a pretty serious crush, I heard all about him.
Yeah, she gets crushes on rapists and sexual assaulters. Yeah, good one.
Ray Rodham, this incredibly brilliant Yale law student who was his girlfriend. And I even got to like her too, which.
Yeah, see, she's proud of her relationship with Hillary too. This is really something.
Took some doing. Anyway, we became friends and stayed friends. And then my family moved to Cape Breton Island and opened a restaurant and a gift shop. And we became really quite, as my father said, we're not bankrupt. We didn't really have a liquidity problem. We couldn't afford groceries, but we did have a lot of inventory. So over the winters, we had tartans and kilts and a physical plant, but we couldn't, couldn't convert that to cash. So I didn't go to university. I stayed waitressing and cooking in my family's restaurant. And one day at bus tour, I was waiting on these lovely people, and they had this soft Southern accent that really reminded me of Bill's accent. So I said to them, by any chance, are you folks from Arkansas? And they said, well, yes, we are. Now, how do y'all know that? I said, well, I had a crush, a really bad crush on a guy from Arkansas.
She had a crush on Bill Clinton. Yeah.
I said, well, who was that? I said, well, his name was Bill Clinton. Governor? And they're all looking around anyway. So that's how we reconnected. We lost track of each other between Connecticut when I left when I was 18, 19, and then the bus driver, ran into Bill on the streets of Little Rock when they got home and said, we ran into some people, know y'all, up in Canada somewhere. So Bill sent the bus driver with a package of things for us. And after that, he would invite my mom to every inauguration. We got back to being in touch and friends. And then he wasn't governor for a while, and then he was again, and then he ran for president. So we are against all odds. I'm federal party leader of the Green Party of Canada, and one of my longtime friends is the former president of the United States. He's just as kind and thoughtful and caring as he could possibly be.
Can you tell the story of the climate conference at the end of 2005, chaired by Stéphane Dion? During an election, you write quite a bit about an anecdote involving the president, former president, and your attempts to get him to come to the climate summit and speak.
Yeah, this was, of course, when Canada hosted the world.
Yeah.
And Montreal was COP11, which is the 11th conference of the parties. And my job, like we all within the environmental movement, particularly at that time, we were really, really effective at splitting up duties. Thinking, okay, we've got this huge opportunity. The first time ever on North American soil, we have a climate negotiation. We can get the U.S. media interested in climate. How do we do that? So that became my job as executive director at the time of Sierra Club of Canada. So I was trying to recruit John Stewart to do the Daily Show from Ottawa. I wrote Bill Clinton, didn't get an answer. Wrote Al Gore, he said he wasn't going to come. I'm trying to get basically an attraction happening besides UN climate negotiations to get the US media to pay attention. And we were already in Montreal. Things were already going pretty badly when suddenly the White House was in touch because it also had an invitation from the mayor of Montreal that Gerald Tremblay was willing to host a session with Bill Clinton. But Bill had this invitation from me, so can you put it together? Can you get, and then I found out that you can't just send the president of the United States, the former president, a ticket. You have to hire and charter private planes. So there I was in sort of the back little, overcrowded environmental group area where we were all trying to get to a phone and it was noisy and crazy and chaotic. And I'm trying to negotiate with charter air companies to get the planes. And then I find out I need to put down $10,000 right away. So I phoned one of my most wonderful friends, the late Glenn Davis from Toronto, who was a philanthropist who supported environmental groups. And I said, Glenn, I kind of need to borrow your Visa card. Can your Visa card handle $10,000? And can I borrow it? Because I need this money in the next half hour, right? So anyway, it all happened. And on the very last day of negotiations, when things would either have been all wrapped up or hanging in the breach, Bill Clinton was going to speak. And it turned out to be the latter. Things were hanging in the breach. The U.S. was not agreeing. This was the U.S. under George Bush. Stéphane Dion was doing an incredibly good job trying to pull things together. And Bill Clinton's speech ended up being the thing that made the U.S. drop its objections because it was so skillful. It was just masterful. So anyway, that's the story. And then while he was speaking, I was standing with his handler people who came with him. And I said, you know that visit I'm supposed to have with him later privately? He said, yeah. I said, can I bring some friends? It hadn't occurred to me before. He said, sure. How many friends do you want to bring? I said, 50. I thought fast. And then I worked through the room and sent people texts, and we rounded up most of the Canadian youth activists, most of the volunteers who'd worked on climate with me for many years. And there's a picture in the book, all of us together, this squashed group. And I didn't put this in the book, Nick, but the thing that was really, really sweet was, it was Bill who said, let's get a picture of all of us together. And he turned to me and he said, Stephanie, you get them all rounded up. And then and he looked at me and said, oh, I always do that. I always call her mother's name.
Oh, isn't that sweet? So Elizabeth May not only has a relationship with Bill Clinton, this is 2014, and I haven't seen anything where she's rejected this relationship or had second thoughts about it. So it's not just a relationship with Bill, but with Hillary that she's proud of. Anyway, I have a little bit of a theme here. So Elizabeth May, I think, is a little tone deaf to abusive personalities or abuse. So later on, Elizabeth May got mixed up in this Jian Ghomeshi controversy. Jian Ghomeshi was a very popular Canadian broadcasting radio personality and TV. He was on TV too, I think. And it came out in 2014 that he was very abusive and violent to women in sexual encounters. And as soon as this came out, Elizabeth May starts tweeting away about how wonderful Jian is and that, you know, he's just got a unconventional sex life. So she was saying, I think Jian is wonderful. Likely too much information for an old fogey like me, but his private life is none of our beeswax. And she said, I have known Jian and something at work here doesn't make sense. Innocent until proven guilty. So she was an apologist for Jian Ghomeshi. And even though he was acquitted, and he was acquitted because his lawyer just victim blamed his the women that he had assaulted. And so there was never going to be any justice against Jian Ghomeshi's assaults. So that's another area where Elizabeth May, she doesn't seem to tap into these abusive men. And she has a history herself, actually. There was an investigation. There were allegations against Elizabeth May herself for workplace bullying. Here we go. So there were three staff members who accused her of verbal and emotional abuse. And so here's this Toronto Star article. And the Green Party, they had to conduct an investigation about this abuse. And because I'm a member, I received this update. And this was dated May 11th. Okay, so this there was a law firm that was hired to investigate the allegations. So here, surprise, surprise, she was cleared. Yes, today we are pleased to inform you that the independent investigator found that the allegations were unfounded. But you know who hired this firm to conduct this investigation? It was the Green Party of Canada. And they circled the wagons. The party really circled the wagons when these accusations of abuse came out. And here's the report itself. And I've read through this. It's a whitewash. And I have been in a situation. I have experienced workplace I've had bosses who are bullies, and it's very subtle, and it's usually explained away, and it's blamed. In this report, when I glanced through it, they failed to recognize that there was an imbalance in power, and Elizabeth May had power over these people. So I believe the allegations of abuse. I think she is a bully when she's a... I think she's a bully towards certain employees, and I'm not buying this that she's been cleared and that they're, I'm just not buying it. So that's my story about Elizabeth May. And I don't think Elizabeth May should be the leader of the Green Party of Canada because of her connections to the Clintons. The Clintons are a bunch of neoliberals. So I don't know, it doesn't speak well of the Green Party of Canada if their leader has this close relationship with a Democratic Party icons who are really more like Republicans. They're not really progressive people at all. So anyway, that's my story for today. I hope you enjoyed this, and have a good weekend. I'll talk to you again soon. Bye.